Hello and welcome to this segment of Arts Talk. I'm joined as a co-host for this segment by Jesse Gallegos. Welcome, Jesse. I'm Sherry Burr, and it's a pleasure to have as our guest Virginia Scharff, who's the author of the book, The Women Jefferson Loved. Welcome, Virginia.
Thank you for having me.
My pleasure. So let's just talk about how you got interested in this particular topic, because so much has been written about Jefferson.
Well, it's funny to think about the fact that when I was a little kid, I used to go to a museum in St. Louis called the Jefferson Memorial, which is now the Missouri History Museum. Mm-hmm. And I can remember as a child, actually, there was a huge snowstorm, and we used to go sledding in Forest Park. And my mom worked at the museum store as a volunteer. Uh-huh. And she went to pick something up on that day of the snowstorm, and I can remember with my brother, we were left outside because we were very snowy and we had our sleds, and no one would leave a child just sitting outside a museum anymore, but she left us outside probably for 45 minutes or something, and the snow was drifted up into the lap of this enormous seated statue of Thomas Jefferson, and we climbed up into his lap.
Oh.
And I think maybe that might have been a pivotal moment in my life. And I'm sure when my mother came out, she was appalled at the idea. Because if you go to St. Louis now and go to the museum, the statue is still there, but it's about 11 or 12 feet in the air.
Wow.
Yeah, a big snowstorm.
Huge climbing. Jesse?
Can you explain the group of women that Jefferson loved that the title refers to? Who are those women?
Well, they're not, I mean, when people talk about this, and when I say I'm writing a book called The Women Jefferson Loved, people would laugh, right? And they, oh, I bet there were a lot of them, right? That kind of thing. And this is not about who his teenage crushes were or who he was rumored to have had an infatuation with. This is about the women that he thought he had a sacred obligation to. So the women in the book whose lives I've explored and whose connection with him that I've looked at are his mother, Jane Randolph Jefferson, his wife, Martha Wales Skelton Jefferson, mm-hmm. his daughters, Patsy and Polly Jefferson, and also his daughter, Harriet Hemings, to a certain extent. Mm-hmm. And then also his granddaughters, who are both on, more on the side of the Jefferson side, the Randolph Jefferson side, than on the and the Epps daughter, granddaughters. Hard to trace those Hemings granddaughters.
Uh-huh. Did you mention Sally in that list?
Yeah, I guess I need to mention her. I guess yeah. I lumped her in with the whole group of Hemings women. It's interesting to think about her too, because her family connection with his family was very intimate, of course, too, because she was half-sister of his wife, Martha, and certainly mm-hmm. somebody he knew from her childhood on, and somebody who was a part of his life until his death.
Right. Yeah, it's interesting. I just came back from Monticello a couple of months ago, and the first question out of the audience mouth was, what about Sally?
Right.
Yeah, so were you, when you started to work this, do the research for this book, were you thinking to start with the mother first, then go to the wife, and then to the mistress?
The first idea that I had was that I was going to write a book about what Thomas Jefferson thought about women.
Oh,
because,
okay.
You know, of course, this is a guy who wrote, all men are created equal. And, of course, we say to ourselves, well, you know, and I remember a history teacher saying to me in graduate school, well, by that he meant men and women. Well, no, he did not. By no means did he mean that men and women were created equal. He believed they were created for complementary purposes by nature. So I wasn't sure what I was going to do with that. I mean, I always admired the Declaration of Independence. I was deeply if you're a Jefferson person, you have a series of disappointments with him. And the first one is, of course, discovering that he was a slaveholder and a racist.
Even though he wrote slavery is an abomination.
I know. And, well, we're going to talk about some contradictions in Jefferson, right?
Yes.
But, so that's the first disappointment. My second disappointment as somebody who writes about the history of women was that he was a sexist as well. He was a believer in inequality, fundamental natural inequality between women and men, but he believed they could not exist without each other. They were fitted by nature for complementary purposes. So that opened up, and once I kind of got sick of thinking about what he thought about women, I became interested in the women themselves. I wondered, you know, what is it that living with somebody like that would be like, and what did they contribute to his life? And at that point, I really wanted to know about women who mattered deeply to him, not women who kind of went in and out of his life.
Right. Jesse?
You mentioned some of the obligations briefly. Could you explain how obligations corresponded with love for Jefferson? I thought that was a fascinating part of the book.
Love became one of the subjects of this book. And I think, you know, each word in the title, we all, when we write books, you want every word in the title to do some work.
Right.
So the is just, you know, right. I wanted to be definitive about it. Women, it's about women. Jefferson, that's, you know, obvious. And then love is a complicated thing because we mm-hmm. tend to sentimentalize love. Mm-hmm. We think of love as this beautiful thing where the butterflies and the birds and the bees kind of flitter around and you're in it kind of a suspended animation of eternal happiness. And in fact, love doesn't guarantee anything. Love can be proprietary, it can be possessive. It can be exhilarating. Mm-hmm. It can be mutually beneficial. It can be harmful. It can be violent. It can be pretty much anything. Mm-hmm. And I think for Jefferson, what love was about was a sense of, your word, Jesse, was a perfect one, obligation. Mm-hmm. So if you have a relationship of love with someone, there is affection involved in it. He was someone who used the word affection in a very frequent way and also in a kind of technical way, because affection was one of the kind of natural capabilities of humans. But it also entailed a sacred obligation mm-hmm. so that you had things you had to deliver. And if you're a man, that meant you would protect women, mm-hmm. provide for them, and ensure that they were safe. Right. So protection and provision are kind of the, we're in a law school, you know, you guys have probably studied protection and provision, some of you. And in return, what women were supposed to do was to nurture, to obey, mm-hmm. and to please. Right. So you're supposed to be the caregivers and you're supposed to naturally understand your interests lie in deferring to the person who, as a person, as a legal person, holds you in a relationship of dependency.
Oh, interesting. I like what you just said in reference to Sally, because that was a complex relationship for many reasons. But interesting, you and several other female historians are taking a look at that relationship from a love perspective.
Right.
Because for so long, male historians even denied that it even existed. And I think Fawn Brody was one of the first to look at this from a love relationship, mm-hmm. saying, look, this lasted 38 years. You don't have a 38-year relationship between a male and female unless there's some love involved.
That's certainly the case. Brody was the first and, of course, almost got run out of the history business for saying this. And there was a concerted campaign to discredit her for saying this. Because I think, and what I've written is that I think that American history up until the time when we began to explore intimate relationships across the color line of various mm-hmm. kinds, we practiced a kind of apartheid history. Mm-hmm. You know, so the history that mattered and the history we recorded was a history of white people in general and white men in particular. Mm-hmm. And there was just this people without a history that existed out there across the color line about whom you just didn't write.
Okay.
You know. So I think that was something that Fawn Brody breached, right. that apartheid, and paid a pretty hefty price for it, but also was on the bestseller list for 11 months. So there was quite a bit of interest in that. Annette Gordon Reed's work about the Hemingses of Monticello, much celebrated work, brilliant work, really begins to look into this more deeply. And then I kind of wanted to bring together the biracial family mm-hmm. that he had, this family uh-huh. that lived in a house divided.
Right.
So 38 years of something called love. And my chief evidence for that is that with all of the scandal that occurred, mm-hmm. With all of the heartbreak, with the bringing of his own daughter in to kind of take over the housekeeping at his house, for all the tension across the color line in this house divided, he never sends Sally away.
Right. And he never did, I did not have sexual relations with that
right.
woman.
You know, he never did a Bill Clinton.
Yeah, he never yeah. denied it, right? Yeah. Never denied it.
Right.
Yeah.
That's certainly the case. So,
and she could have stayed in France, right? He practically begged her to come back.
It would appear. I mean, the way that she described, I love the way that she described it to her son, Madison Hemings. She called it a treaty. Yeah. And of course, you know, when she's dealing with him in France, he's American ambassador, he's American minister to France.
Right. And she's free then.
Right. She's legally free in France. Yes. So, you know, she comes back with him. So that bespeaks a variety of things, probably some affection, probably some awe right. on her part. I mean, he's a 43-year-old, incredibly powerful person, and she's a, you know, 18-year-old girl, right, who doesn't really speak a lot of French. She's starting to learn it, but in the middle of the French Revolution, there are reasons to go back home where her family is, but I think also some affection on her and some respect and, you know, who knows, maybe some infatuation. I would have been impressed with him. Mm-hmm. I have to say, you know, let's remember we're talking about Thomas Jefferson here. You know, it's right. not just your average dude, right?
Right.
So there's something
right.
about him.
Right. And then all the descriptors of him as being tall and handsome
right.
and having a really good bearing.
Right. And witty and, you know, charming and all that stuff. But at the same time, I mean, the other thing that I think demonstrates his love for her is that according to the terms of this verbal treaty that they had that brought her back to America, he promised that any children that they had would be free.
Right.
And if you think about the laws of the United States at that time, you know, basically that's what he's saying to her is, I'm going to, you know, these expensive pieces of highly valuable and skilled property.
Right.
Will walk away.
Exactly.
And, you know, that's a big thing, especially when you consider that the guy died so deeply in debt that everything right. else had to be sold.
Right, and he owned over 400 slaves in his life, and he only freed 9 of them, all of them connected to Sally Hemings.
That's right.
Yes, Jesse?
There's a fascinating contrast between the intimacy and the oppression and almost the regime of silence and steps taken to maintain the privacy. Do you think this was a pretty concerted effort by Jefferson throughout his life? And was he able to successfully reconcile these contrasting traits?
Well, you know, if you think about sort of intimacy and oppression and exploitation and lies and secrets and silences, my question, once I got deeply enough into this, is who doesn't live with that? Right? I mean,
right.
this is kind of, every family has some kind of story like this.
Mm-hmm.
His happens to be a story that belongs in many ways to all of us. And so to see more of those relationships makes him more accessible
mm-hmm.
to us, I mean, more human
yes.
to us, and more more interesting because there are these kinds of contradictions. But I would say, you know, we talked a little bit before and you say, you know, well, how is it possible to love women and be a misogynist at the same time, right? And I would say, you know, ask, you know, lots of guys, right? Ask lots of women. It's certainly possible to love and hate somebody at the same time. And it's certainly possible for a human being to have sex with somebody they don't enjoy very much on a lot of other levels.
And on that note, we're going to wrap up this first segment of Arts Talk, and we'll be right back to take questions from our studio audience. Thank you.